Everywhere we look, we see hurting people. So many people protesting, and rightly so, because a man being killed by police officers, 40 million people unemployed. We see also all these people that are hurting and had the coronavirus, over a million. The need is all around us. How do we respond? Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we see this hurt. We see this pain. We hear the lamenting, Almighty God. We see that some that are not being heard or even turning to rioting, Lord. God, we come to you at this particular time, and we're asking to pour your Holy Spirit down on us. We need help. We need you. We ask you to just teach us through all this, Lord God. Help us not to retreat, but help us to be people of faith, to be able to understand what you're trying to say to us at this hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. N.T. Wright had said in Time magazine the following, and I quote, "No doubt some will tell me why God is doing this. A punishment? A warning? Perhaps a biblical tradition we really need to turn to is lament. Lament is what happens when people ask why and don't get an answer. It's where we get to when we move beyond self-centered worry about our failings and look at the suffering of the world. In the Bible, God also laments. The Spirit groans." And he goes on and says, "Jesus weeps. God grieves for his world. It's not part of the Christian vocation to be able to explain what is happening and why. In fact, it is part of the vocation not to be able to explain and to lament instead. As the Spirit laments within us, so we become small shrines where the presence and healing love of God can dwell, and out of that can emerge new possibilities, new acts of kindness, new scientific understanding, and new hope." Why are we, as the people of God, not able to hear the groans? The groans who are suffering, the people who are suffering from police brutality and bigotry. Why can't we hear the groans of people who are suffering from the coronavirus? And many of these are the same individuals that are stepped on by society as a whole because they're not getting adequate medical treatment, and they're the first to die, whether it's in nursing homes or alone in the hospital rooms. So many people hurting. And we take a look at our Bibles, we see throughout the Bible people that are lamenting. Maybe that's why we haven't had church in big assemblies for a while, because God wants us to hear the cries of the people. He tells us that in the book of Isaiah and other scriptures. He's right now calling forth his people to turn from their wicked ways, that they might repent, and he can hear and heal their land. And our land needs healing at this particular time. And how can it have healing unless we hear the cries of the people? That's why instead of retreating from protests, that's why instead of withdrawing and self-quarantining to the extent that we can't even feel what people are feeling, it's time that we understand, yes, it is more than just praise, as important as that may be. There's also lament. People that can hear the cries, the frustration, and move in through the light of the Word of God. We see that, you know, that God is telling us through His Word, like in Romans 8:22, we know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth. As we study the biblical teachings, we see the landscape is just covered with lament. We see it throughout the Bible. We see people crying out before God. We see it coming forth from the Psalms, but somehow we've missed all of that. Now we're seeing it and feeling it as a nation. And will there be healing until we can begin to feel what people are feeling, till we can begin to understand what people are experiencing, till we can begin to let God's light and love flow in us and through us at this particular moment? All right, let's take a look at Isaiah 24, verse 4. It says, "The earth dries up and withers, the world languishes and withers, the exalted of the earth languish." And then he goes on and says in Psalm 10, 2 through 4 and 9 and 10, "In his arrogance the wicked hunts down the weak who are caught in the schemes he devises. He boasts of the cravings of his heart. He blesses the greedy and reviles the Lord. In his pride the wicked does not seek him. In all his thoughts there's no room for God. He lies in wait like a lion in cover. He lies in wait to catch the helpless. He catches the helpless and drags him off in his net. His victims are crushed. They collapse. They fall under his strength." If it had not been for social media, where the world had seen how George Floyd died at the hands of a police officer with his knee on his neck and three other officers standing by, or their knees also upon him, where the world had seen that the two men that was just looking for a man to chase down, a man of color, that they could shoot him in Georgia, thank God for social media, but that which has been done in the dark is coming into the light, and the groaning is taking place. The hurting is coming forth. I do not condone the violence of rioters, but I must hear the lament of the of people that are hurting, people that have been victims for so many years. And now it's coming forth at this particular hour. If our country is going to experience healing, if we as people of God are going to experience healing, we must hear the lament of the downtrodden, the poor, the fatherless, the widow, the hurting, and the homeless. So many crying out to God at this time. So many of the businesses that were set on fire and windows broken out of were the same businesses that were pushing to close 1411 Locust Street and have left the homeless on the streets now without any day center place for over 3 years now. Yes, we have to pray for those that despitefully use us and persecute us. But more so, we must hear the lament of those that are crying out to God at this particular moment. The question is, when are we as a church, as a body of Christ, going to start hearing the cries of those that are in need? God would go on and tell us in Isaiah chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. He says, when you appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling of my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. And he goes on and says in Amos chapter 5, 23 and 24, away with the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps, but let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. We see this both what is happening among the poor and needy, and we also see it in creation as a whole. As our cited verse earlier, all of creation is groaning for the redemption of mankind. When humanity is truly redeemed, it's more than just a bunch of people getting together, telling God how much they love Him, and just engaging what they refer as worship as for them a feel-good experience. If we truly want to worship God, we'll engage in worship service in response to the lament that we hear all around us. And this lament has been growing and growing and growing until massive numbers of people are gathering together. And many of the people we see in the crowd aren't wearing masks. They should be wearing those masks. And others may be exposing themselves. But then when you ask, aren't you worried about COVID-19, they'll say yes. And many wearing masks. I'm aren't. There may be a resurge. But the response is also, I'm more concerned about COVID-19, the year slavery started in this country, and the bigotry continuing to come forth today. We need to pray. We need to lament. We need to understand. We need to let God's light and love work with us and thank God for all those that are coming forth and gathering their brothers and sisters, regardless of the color of their skin, saying we are one in spirit. We hear your cries, and we want to stand in solidarity at this particular moment. We as people of the body of Christ who take communion should be a people that really recognize the whole spirit of lament. The whole aspect of communion comes out of Christ sharing His body, sharing His blood. Christ preparing His people for the suffering that He's going to experience. As He's hanging on the cross, He cries out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He bridges the gap between creeds and deeds, and often getting directly involved in the lives of the hurting and the needy causes us to also find ourselves bridging such a gap, not to the extent that Christ did, where He actually died for all of us on the cross and suffered the ultimate punishment for our sins, only to conquer death and be resurrected. But a lot of people want to stay away from the poor and needy because it will rob them of their joy. Can you really have authentic joy until you understand that the joy of the Lord is my strength, and I experience that joy because I've become one with those who are hurting, those who are lament? Many, many times when I'll start out, and I frequently do this on Sunday morning, put 25, 30 bags of all different kinds of items in my car, and I say, Lord, show me those who are calling out unto you. Help me to hear their cries. In the past 2 weeks in a row, I've found woman that it was dropped off in the middle of the night in a strange city because things were messed up with her bus ticket. The police didn't know what to do. They didn't actually drop them off. They told her to meet them in the park next to St. Patrick's Center. Counselors aren't there on Sunday, and I'd find these women under trees or being out there, often terrified, and then we're able to refer them to such safe houses. But in order to pray, we have to feel what they're feeling. We have to hear what God is hearing as they cry out to Him for help. And then our spirit has to move us into the midst and into the pain where we can become instruments of His healing and hope at such a time like this. And that's a challenge that exists for each and every one of us, that we can hear the prayers of those that need, that we can cry out along with what God is trying to say to us in Psalm 72, verse 4. He'll defend the afflicted among the people and will save the children of the needy. He will crush the oppressor. And we see this crushing unfolding at this time. We see the anger being released as people are breaking out these windows. We see setting fires and just explosion that's taking place. If there's going to be healing in our land, the people of God need to do what some are doing. After all the glass broken out, they'd go out there and they'd help clean up the next day. Police officers in communities where protests have taken place have gotten down on their knee, and protesters have joined them. And there's been instruments of healing. The police have been in those cases. Police chiefs have gotten down among the people. God is a miracle working God, and healing unfolds. Healing takes place. We need to be such instruments of healing, not condoning the rioting. And after all, rioting is what happens when people aren't heard, but instead being instruments of God's healing power at such a time like this. In order to do that, we need to enter into prayer. We need to be able to hear what the Lord is saying. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, He says, "My people who are called by My name will turn from their wicked ways. I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land." We need to go before God. We need to cry out unto Him at this particular hour. We need to say, "Lord, help me to hear the cries that You're hearing. And Lord, give me Your grace and give me Your power to respond to such cries at this particular time." We need to gather together. And if we're engaged in large protests, wear the masks. We need to cry out for those that are suffering. The over 1 million people tested positive for the coronavirus. For the 100,000 people and their families who have died as a result of the coronavirus. And those that have died at the hands of police brutality or other brutality, and no one knows except their family members. May God's grace be upon them, and may we hear their cries. May we be there with them at this hour of need as we go before God and cry out to Him for help and healing for our country. George Herbert, that great poet from the 1600s in England, talked about the power of prayer. And he said, "Prayers reversed thunder, Christ's side-piercing spear, the 6 days' world transposing in an hour." What he was referring to was Revelation chapter 8, verses 4 through 5, where it actually talks about reversed thunder. In other words, our prayers actually bring about big changes, not just here on earth, but also in heaven itself. And this is what it says: "The smoke of the incense rose with the prayers of the saints from the hand of the angel before God. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar and threw it on earth. And there were peals of thunder, voices, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake." This scene reverses what usually happens on earth. You know, we pray and we see things happen from heaven and take place and changes on earth. Well, also we pray and here we see it happening in heaven. And as we say that, I remember where the scriptures speak of the fact that God holds in His hands the thoughts and intents of the hearts of those that are in authority. We need to pray. We need to be praying right now that God will turn their hearts of those that are in leadership and to the hearts of the poor and the needy. We need to be praying that our president discovers compassion for the poor and needy, and will reach out and be president of all people. We need to be praying that God will touch his heart and he can begin to feel what that poor mother feels, that African-American mother that's worried every time her child has interaction with the police. For that one that is feeling the hurt and the pain and the isolation alone in that nursing home at this particular time, or that one that's on the ventilator. They can begin to feel it and express such compassion rather than trying to look like he's going to do everything he can to just quiet the demonstrators, chasing them out of Lafayette Park so he can stand before a church holding a Bible. We have to ask God to enable the words in that Bible to pierce his heart. The Bible says, pray for those that are in authority, that they may come to know God in a very special and powerful way. We need to be praying at this time for our communities, and we need to be able to hear the cries of the poor and the needy and hear their lament at such a time like this. When believers pray, things begin to unfold. The very heavens begin to shake. God is moving at this time. But he just doesn't want it business as usual. We gather together and just tell God how much we love him and lock our doors. It's to the poor and the needy in our hearts. It's too late to play church. We have to be church. And being church involves also hearing the lament of those that are in need. If someone was to stand up in the middle of the church service and cry out, I'm in pain, I'm hurting, my family's in pain, I'm tired, I'm sick and tired. You know the stuff you hear in the Psalms. They'd probably call the police and have them escorted out. And what are the poor police supposed to do? We expect the police to solve everybody's problems as we shut down the mental hospitals and all these different places, and people are left out there with their pain, their worry, and their trauma. The woman I talked to yesterday when I was out in worship service had walked all night from Springfield, Missouri to St. Louis. She'd arrived at a very traumatic hour, and everything was in total turmoil. She said, no place to use a bathroom. Nobody wanted to offer any help, hope. She couldn't even find a place to lay down until she came upon an encampment of homeless people and found some help there from fellow homeless people. The despair, the hurt, the pain. God prompted my heart after talking to her to welcome her to our safe house. In the meantime, to go to the car and take out the last sleeping bag I had and what other help that I had on me that I could offer her at that particular moment in the midst of her lament. But I have to confess before God, there's so many times I do not hear the cries. I do not hear the lament. All I see is the trouble that the person may be causing through their outbursts, through their expression as such, and I have a tendency to retreat. God, forgive me. A tendency to close myself off to such. God, forgive me. Lord, help me to hear the lament of the people around me. And as long as I can hear it, God can continue to trust me to come in contact with them. When I start shutting myself down, then he can't send them to me. Forgive me, Lord, is my cry to God at this particular moment. And Jesus is telling all of us at this time as we search his word. He said, come to me. He says, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will hear your cry. Come to me, all you who labor and heavy laden, and I will be there for you. And how is he there for him at this time? Yes, there are many times he divinely intervenes, but many times he desires to speak to his people that they might hear what he is hearing each and every day as they cry out before him with nowhere to go, no one to help them, as they're totally alone in their distress. If the people of God don't hear them, who will hear them? Or will it all just continue to fester inside and fester inside until peaceful protest turn into mobs, destroying buildings, breaking out windows, attacking police officers, and then the so-called self-righteous will stand back and support those that want to come in with a heavy hand, call out the National Guard, call out the militia, call out the military, and crush the lament. God help us as his people. God help us as his people that we can truly do that. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and they know me, and they follow me. And in the midst of all the other voices around, we very infrequently hear the voice of Jesus because it's muffled by all the other voices. We need to hear what he is saying to us at this particular time. We see this woman in Luke chapter 8, 43 through 48, touching the very hem of Jesus' garment and experiencing healing. How we need to hear, how we need to reach out and touch the hem of Jesus' garment. It's so easy to despair at this particular moment. It's so easy just to give up. The rest of the world is watching at this moment. We refer to ourselves as a Christian nation, and that involves more than the president running off peaceful protesters so he can walk over to a church and hold up a Bible. All he's doing is reflecting how he sees so many evangelical Christians respond, and he wants their vote. May God forgive us. May God heal us. May God have mercy upon us as a people at this time. To be an evangelical Christian means to believe that this is the Word of God, and we believe that this is the Word of God. We're going to see that he is a God of love and a God that's hearing the cries of the people. So we must hear such. We must not, in our fears of what's happening around us, get in those long lines to see if we can buy a gun to protect ourselves. Because unless the Lord watches the house, the watchmen watch in vain. We need to look to Him at this time. Truly, if we're believers, we're going to allow His light and love to flow within us. And we're not going to run from the hurts and the cries of the poor and needy. We're going to ask God to help us to hear them and to move in the midst of them. For as He said, my sheep hear my voice, and they know me, and they follow me. And the question comes back, are you truly one of His sheep? Do you truly know Him? Have you truly received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Or have you experienced, you know, what so many are looking for right now? They're looking for a cure to the coronavirus, a disease that's out there. They're looking for, a flu shot, get a little bit of flu to keep from getting the real thing. Seeing those that have had the virus, if you can get somehow some kind of response and healing through that to give to those that keep from getting it. Well, what I'm saying is that this, do we just have just enough of a shot of religion to keep from getting the real thing? Just enough to support those that are engaged in heavy-handedness. Just enough to want to get together and have a real good religious feeling. Just enough to look and convince ourselves we're real nice people. Just enough to isolate ourselves. But we don't have the real thing. Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of God, but who does the will of my Father, that's in heaven. But Lord, in your name, didn't we heal the sick? In your name, didn't we do this, that, and the other? And He says, get away from me, I never knew you. What do you want me to do? Matthew 25, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, did you visit me? When I was a stranger, did you welcome me? As oft you done to the least, He said, even so, you've done it unto me. And in order to do that, we need to hear the lament of the people that are hurting right now. Many are alone in nursing homes. So many. So much hurt, so much pain. I can't be in all those nursing homes, but I can pray for those that are. And I can try to listen to what God is trying to tell me at such a time like this and how I can respond. I can't be with everybody that's out on the streets, but I can be calling out unto God. I can be asking Him to show me. Show me, Lord. Show me who we're to invite into our homes, into our safe houses, into our residential training program. Show me, Lord, who's hungry at this particular time. Show me, Lord. And through your prayers, you can be among those that are lamenting. But prayer does not become an excuse for non-involvement. Prayer does, and church going does not become an excuse for not involvement. Church going should not be going and going like you're going to the local country club. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. brought out that how between like 10 and noon, it's the most segregated hour in America. God forbid. We need to begin to move among and see that we're all God's children, regardless of the color of our skin. And we need to be able to hear the cries of those that are being brutalized, those that are being hurt, those that feel like there's a greater virus at work than COVID-19, and that's COVID-16-19, and they're willing to expose themselves and go with large groups of people and engage in peaceful protests. May we hear the cries of the poor and needy. Yes, I believe that it's important that we follow the Word of God. I'm not going to just tell you what maybe you want to hear to tickle your ears. I think it's important that we hear what God hears. I think it's important that we can identify with those that God feels for day after day, and that we can be as instruments of healing. Yes, the new normal is totally different than what it was in the past. Smaller groups of people meeting, smaller groups of people worshiping together. But let our worship truly engage in worship service in response to the lament that's constantly going to heaven in the form of a prayer. Let us pray. Father God, I come to you right now in the name of Jesus, and I ask that we might be able to hear the lament in the world around us. To the extent, Lord, that we will be your instruments of healing, your instruments of hope, your instruments of life. Forgive us, Lord, when we get so obsessed with ourselves and our religious experience that we become the Pharisees that you deplored. Help us, Lord. Deliver us from a Pharisaic attitude. Help us, Lord Jesus, to reach out as you reached out. Help us, Lord God, to hear your voice, for we truly desire to be your sheep at this time. We truly want to obey you, Lord God. We want to be someone that you can speak to, Lord, that we can let your love flow through and plant those seeds of love and hope at this hurting hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come. In the name of Jesus we ask this. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.
You feeling lonely, fearful, depressed, discouraged? Then call the dial-a message at this time, 314-241-7000. A special message just for you, to encourage you, to enlighten you, to help you move from a realm of depression into a realm of hope.